Brahms sent this letter to Clara Schumann. "To me, the Chaconne is one of the most beautiful, incredible compositions. On one staff, and for a small instrument, this man pours out a world full of the most profound thoughts and most powerful emotions. If one cannot avail oneself of the most outstanding violinist, perhaps the greatest enjoyment of the Chaconne is to be achieved in one's mind. And I'd like to take just a tiny moment to think about two of the things that he said there. One of them is, you need a live person so you can hear the music. And I think we can remember, probably not back that far, any of us. We could drop a needle, now we can just push a button. In Brahms' day, you had to have flesh and blood and bone in order to have the music. And the other thing he says is, the greatest enjoyment is to be achieved in one's mind. Think about that for a moment. I know people, my wife is one of them, where I say, what are you doing? She says, I am enjoying this meal because I am reading the recipe and I don't have to be annoyed with the food. I don't have this capability, either in music or in food. So understanding it takes a little stretch of the imagination, but it definitely was there for Brahms. As a matter of fact, when a certain conductor was appearing with Don Giovanni in the 1890s with the Vienna Opera, Brahms's friends exhorted him to go, and he gruffly replied, when I want to enjoy Don Giovanni, I take the score and lie on my couch with it. In other words, he didn't want any musicians messing it up for him. The conductor was Gustav Mahler. Brahms's friends got him there, and he liked it. As a matter of fact, after Act One, he said, a devil of a fellow, I've got to meet him. So I like the crusty old Brahms could still be persuaded by actual heard sounds. He continues, after all, one does not always care to hear this music in one's thoughts. Joachim is not here very often, and therefore one occupies oneself in various ways with this music. Whatever I try, orchestra or piano, it always ruins my enjoyment. Only in one way do I succeed in coming close to a very reduced, yet quite pure enjoyment of this work, and that is if I play it alone with the left hand. The similar difficulty, the kind of technique, the arpeggiation, all of this adds up to make me feel like a violinist. Brahms wrote a lot of studies for the piano, some for just, you know, using your fingers, others arrangements, a couple of other arrangements for right-hand pieces for the left hand. And he calls this a study too, but I'm pleased by the fact, deeply, that he wrote it for his own enjoyment, not just for his own motions of his fingers. So that's Brahms on the piece, and then I want to give you my take on the piece and talk about the piece itself as well. So this is the Chaconne is a dance form. It actually, I was amazed to find out it originates in Mexico, and it made its way to Spain by the 16th century, and then to the rest of Europe. And this piece is a series of 62 variations on four measures that are presented right in the beginning. And it falls into three large parts. It's been arranged for everything, let me tell you. As a matter of fact, we know the violinist Ferdinand David played it in 1840 with Mendelssohn adding an accompaniment at the piano. It's been arranged for large orchestra, xylophones, Busoni's arrangement for both hands on the piano, which really just puffs the work up completely. I even must tell you that I heard a very satisfying arrangement of it done just 2 years ago for four violas. And it was played very beautifully by my colleagues here at the conservatory a few months ago. It's not the most dramatic presentation, but it's very clear, and it has a kind of leisureliness that's not, I think, what the music is, but is still very satisfying. Bach always prevails. There's almost nothing you can do to destroy him, as long as you pretty much play the notes that are there. And for that, he's that's a great thing to have that. What's remarkable about Brahms' version, though, especially written in 1877, is rather than puff it up, he cuts it down. When you think of Liszt arrangements of pieces, how they just add notes all over the place, so does Busoni too, and Brahms takes one hand away from you and leaves you just with the left hand, so it's very unusual in that respect. Just listen to the first four measures of what's going on here. Because I was a little concerned, since this piece has been with me all my life, and I'll give you a couple of the circumstances that it's been with me with, that I wasn't perhaps hearing it anymore. There's a cartoon in my studio upstairs. It shows a gentleman sitting at the piano, and he's saying, "I'm not enjoying this at all." And the caption reads, "When you know you're a professional." So, the best commencement speech I ever heard in my life, even in real universities where I taught, was Saul Joseph, the first year I was here at the conservatory. He pointed to the opening of the Ninth Symphony of Beethoven and how they had studied in the class that the certain 30-some measures of that opening are all on an A pedal, and you don't know the piece, the real key of the piece. And he said, there's a big danger that once you know that information, your sense of wonder will evaporate. The knowledge will replace that. He said, don't let that happen. And he sat down. And he raised a very profound point about what it is that experience does to our ability to perceive something freshly. I want to share my fresh thoughts with you on the first four measures. Gleaned this morning. Because this piece was sitting on our piano at home when I was 4 years old. Not that my parents were professional musicians, but they didn't play the piano, but they had it was a Brahms thing, and I saw this piece with the left hand. Then when I was 10 years old, we rented a house on the main shore, and my father made it his business to be learning the Chaconne on the viola that summer. And so whilst I was playing around in tidal pools and those kid things you do when you're a kid, this music was going on all the time. Then I spent years practicing it on the viola for my own pleasure. It was never shareable with people because it wasn't listenable, but I was having a good time. So the thing was totally in my ears, and I started, you know, getting used to it. Here's what conclusion I came to about some things that we shouldn't get used to. And it follows everything in this first four measures. For one thing, you don't even know what beat you're on because he starts on the second beat of the measure. So it's like one, two, three. One, two, three. And I mean, that's amazing. Secondly, the third chord in this piece is almost apocalyptic in its power. I stopped hearing that chord. What the? Right after what he does there, and then he has to lower this, and then he offers this thing that pours oil on these troubled waters. Enables you to emerge. So we have a rhythmic thing. The rhythm doesn't get righted until we get to this theme 8 bars later. notes for every one of the variations of the piece. I feel like this is the world of the Old Testament. It's dark, it's full of, it reaps the whirlwind. It's a kind of thing that Brahms really found himself taken with in the four serious songs, in the clarinet quintet, in the E minor cello sonata. These are all craggy works. Bach hated writing variations, and he only wrote two major sets. There's this one, and then there's this one. Its first four measures are totally illuminated. There are no dark corners, there's no strife, there's no whirlwind. It's just like a kind of a world of the Greek epics where sunlight is everywhere and you see every place. And I think, you know, these works which were written, this was in Kirchen in 1720, Goldberg Variations some 22 years later, couldn't be more different. And the way they unfold, of course, is completely different as well. In the Goldberg Variation, there's an accruement of things to that opening theme. Here, the music takes every element of this opening and expands it lyrically, rhythmically, dynamically, in ways that just seem to be full of the ripest imagination and the utmost order and precision of all of the details. For listening purposes of this narrative, because I'm fascinated with the idea of music as narrative, and the excellent program notes that were written on the program really talk about that idea of narrative, I wanted to explore two narratives tonight. This first narrative, if we look at the large picture now, falls into three main sections. And the proportions are really nice. It's really 3-2-1. The first section has 32 variations, the second 20, and the third 10. And the second group begins with a very startling event. After there's an open case, this middle section has that two-thirds proportion, and then the final section returns to the material of the opening, but with a most interesting progression that takes us back. He cadences like this. Great spiritual journeys. It's been pointed out, and I think it's a stretch really, but it's a good stretch, I think, that the piece suggests three ages of man. The first section being youthful and impassioned with a lot of craggy intensity. Sorry. The second section is, this is the problem of talking with your hands, they tend to occasionally touch the wrong thing. The second section more the expansion of middle age in this D major. And then when he comes back at the end to the section that's only one third as long, old age. The last section has a wisdom about it, a kind of a deep contumely. It feels like one is wiser at the end. The Goldbergs do a little bit of that too when the theme comes back at the very end. But this is, you know, compared to the Goldbergs variations with the repeats, hour and 20 minutes or so, this thing is just a fraction of that time. And yet I think it encompasses the same spiritual intensity and the same kind of story, a kind of a narrative. So hope you enjoy this. When we come to the Schubert, then we're going to take a 5-minute break between this and the Schubert, by the way, and then we'll be talking about a completely different a different kind of narrative at that point. Thank you. course, it feels like you're just speaking into black space. And also, we're going to have a couple of gentlemen said they had some questions. And I thought it would be nice to have a question and answer period after we play Schubert, before we send all ourselves home with the Abendlied of Schumann. So, why did Schubert have to die when he was 31? I mean, what he's doing here is kind of an amazing thing. Donald Francis Toby speaks of Schubert's heavenly length. And there is actually heavenly length in this piece, except it's very short. It's the same thing that the passage of time is a confusing thing. Sometimes time that lies heavy on our hands goes by very slowly, especially in retrospect. And the time that we're very busy and engaged, which seems to have flown out the window, expands in retrospect because we've done all of these things in that time. And I think this time sense is a little bit what I try to tell my students about fortissimo. That fortissimo is not necessarily a measure of decibels. And this makes a lot of sense. So what Schubert's doing here is taking us through a whole journey of four movements in a very compressed frame. It's also, for Schubert, very dark music. I started to think about what pieces does Schubert write like this? Okay, there's the Death of the Maid quartet, but you still have that tarantella at the end. You know, yeah, it's dark and it ends in a very forceful way, but you're definitely hoofing it in the end. And when you think of the end of the last three sonatas, even the tarantella and the C minor sonata, especially the A major and the B flat, the great symphony, these last movements and the great D major piano sonata and the G major piano sonata, as we say at home, you go to the seashore in these movements. I mean, they're expansive and they're positive. This thing just comes back to this dark beginning. In that respect, it's very akin, I think, to the Chaconne of Bach, that it's a dark universe. And completely different from the Bach, its world is as spare as could possibly be. So, for instance, just the opening measures are this. From this to this, and then you feel the shifting planes of the universe that you're living in. It's just remarkable what small increments add up to mean. And when you get this, add to it really makes a difference. So That's the material for the opening. We have another tune here. That will become the subject of the fugue at the end. And by the way, this is the only real significant fugue that Schubert wrote in his instrumental music. That's why I wanted him to live a little longer. Maybe we would have gotten another one out of it. And I'm going through this, I'm sorry to quote chapter and verse so assiduously, but I think it really adds to the listening experience when you kind of know where you are. We're going to take this trip around the lake. There's Joe's pub. That's the wharf. And we'll be stopping here. And then you will be in sight of our embarkation point when you hit this mountain and come back. Makes the trip more fun. So I just want to play this other major thing here. This is another really amazing place, with it just for its calm. So that's the material of the first movement. Then we have a largo. With a very gentle middle. We can just play this thing, like, just to show this thing. These parts get passed around between mostly my students and myself. At that point, there's an emoji in the music. See? I said to Hye Yeong, did you put that emoji in the music? It's a little smiling one. And you violently denied it. It was Teresa Yu when she used to play this with Julio. That would be Teresa. Her emoji lives in this music from 15 years ago. And it's perfectly appropriate. So after the largo section, there is a an Allegro Vivace Scherzo. We can just show the theme. Even that, for all its good spirits, is still in a kind of a dark key. The middle trio section, however, is in the major, and it absolves that. So, after the trio and the middle section, which I think are pretty simple to understand, we come back. Well, the thing about that opening tune is, and this is what Schubert does new. How many times did he bring it back? Three times? Four times? It's totally unexpected. Beethoven liked to return to themes. He does it in some of his late works, but usually just once in the C major cello sonata. And in the Opus 101 piano sonata. But here Schubert uses it in a different way. It's kind of a leitmotif. It comes back and it keeps reminding you that you're mortal. I mean, that's the devastating. I mean, you may have different opinions, but I feel that that's the part about this piece that's most sobering, that you can't escape time. You can't escape this motto. Even when it's in F major, that's just a kind of illusion. It's really a minor thing. So you'll hear that again after the scherzo. And then that turns into the to the fugue. Now, one of Hye Yeong's friends mentioned, and I think she was very right, we were talking about this the other morning, that the fugue is the hardest thing to get. And I thought it might be good to help a little bit for us and for the audience, for you guys, to just parse out what's going on here. Remember this tune. That is very clearly from the first movement, and then you have the counter subject. I think it's very important that the counter subject the subject are not getting along very well. subject is, I mean, these could describe two personalities, one rather forceful and aggressive, and the other somewhat diffident, somewhat retreating. And notice, if you look more deeply, that all it is filling in some of the notes between. So it's very organic in that respect, and you'll hear these things going on against each other. And then there's a third element that we tend to forget, and I guess that's the triplets, right? Play that. Just the triplets by themselves. And that's going to develop into a long line. Those are the only three things that are going on. And I don't think, I think we can leave it to your imagination and interest that when we're playing it, if we can manage to be very clear, then you can hear all of these elements participating. And they are definitely, I believe, trying to get somewhere. They're trying to make some progress. But in point of fact, they don't. And they, just let's show the way that breaks off. Can we, you know, maybe just here. What's a good spot? Three bars in total.
How about?
Is that you?
Yeah.
Okay. It's very important to do this. 551. Yes.
Okay.
Let's get a little load of this. I mean, what's that? Just a sudden, and there's a long silence, and then, of course, there's nowhere to go, is there, except. Maybe not with full mane of emotion, but just to show what's going on. Finally, you get every interval. And then you have to wait a very long time for the C. So, that is the stuff of your mortality. Every note that's in there. And it's an extraordinary circumstance. Not happy music. And it's, in a way, a kind of a difficult music to grasp. That's why I want to have a question period after it. I also want to point out something else, that this form, hold up your hand, do we belong to the same species? I mean, how do you manage one instrument with two people? People have a hard enough time managing a whole household, let alone this. And this form, according to the British historian Worsley, she thinks this form began for amorous adventures, that it got people closer together than they do in string quartets. And indeed, in one of Schubert's rondos, you have to reach through here to get to the top part. There's no question that this form of music was for parlors, where in the 19th century, pianos were very, very popular instruments. So Schubert just turned this thing on its ear. He wrote four volumes of stuff. And a lot of it is, you know, very lovely, beautifully crafted, lightweight music. And then you get this. How does this come out of that genre? I mean, this is a completely, this is like, you know, Winterreise of a four-hand piano. And it sets up a kind of, you know, there's a kind of struggle that goes on at the keyboard, especially in this piece. He doesn't take very good care of you. And there are a lot of places where your hands literally bump into each other. And you have to figure out some modicum of fluency to get through that darn thing. But you don't want too much fluency. I like to tell my students, it's like a drama about people who don't have problems. I mean, how come I have all these problems and you have none? So the friction, I think, is part of the fulfillment. So hope you enjoy it, and think of any interesting questions when you finish.
Thank you.
Should have answered it. Thank you for bringing it up. It's almost literal. He does add some sustaining notes in the lower registers, and he holds on to some notes that the violin wouldn't be able to hold on to. He also gives pretty explicit pedal markings and dynamics, none of which, of course, are in the original Bach score. So I think of it as a kind of translation. It goes into another language, and I really try very assiduously to do everything Brahms wrote to the best of my ability, because what he's doing is casting a kind of vision on this thing, and I think a very caring and sensitive one. And, you know, I don't think anybody would ever play the Chaconne without adding a lot of marks of expression, but when you face a Bach score with absolutely nothing written in it, it's up to the, you know, it's to the performer to figure that range out, and Brahms has done this. But I wouldn't say he's done it in a stifling way. You know, he's not Michael. It's not like looking at an Alban Berg score or a Milton Babbitt score where you feel like you are being owned by the composer, you know, and you have no hegemony.
I wanted to give you another opportunity to talk about the differences of the works and possibly throw something else in there. I'm thinking of Carl Berger's book from about 15 years ago, Bach's Cycle, Mozart's Era, in which he talks about Bach as being, in some sense, a reactionary that wasn't willing to accept this new thing called sonata form, which was associated with the Enlightenment. And he didn't like these ideas that there would be these planes of tonality where you would start in one and then arrive at another, because his religious beliefs led him to the conclusion that we are always struggling upward, and no matter how far we get, there's always another level to go. And so this was the premise of that book.
I don't know the book.
It's a fascinating idea that I'm not sure that I agree with. But here we have two works. We have a work by Bach that you've talked about a narrative in, and a work by Schubert where the story, plot line is so dramatically different. And I'm just wondering if you could talk a little more about, you know, what you think Bach was trying to say, as opposed to, say, for instance, why Schubert would bring in a fugue near the end of the work, which is quite a dramatic rhetorical gesture.
Absolutely. And what was going through Schubert's mind, he wrote this in the last 4 months of his life. Was the last 4 months or the last 6 months of his life? It's right from very, it's in 1828, it's right at the end there. You know, with Bach, and I think this comes out if you look at the John Elliott Gardiner things on the cantatas and the cantata tour, Bach's workload was beyond belief. I mean, he was just cranking out a cantata every week in Leipzig for, 27 years or something. And so he had hardly time to think other than to get the notes down. Is there even a scrawled rejection of one of his sons copying because he didn't go fast enough and he made too many mistakes? So how Bach kept up the quality level with that pace is amazing. And as you mentioned, Schubert's pace was incredible too. We do a seminar here just in the works of his last year. And it's not, you know, I'm sure Telemann wrote as many pieces in one year as Schubert. They're just not quite as good. I mean, the genius of Schubert's last year, when you think of all the works in it and how earth-shattering they are and how good they are and how they're always challenging form. I think the feeling at the end of the fantasy is probably most akin to the feeling at the end of the Winterreise with Der Leiermann, which also, remember, has no modulations. It's just a fifth chord for the whole piece. And it talks about a cockatoo-like image of being frozen in the ice. And that's one of the most, you know, anybody, sure, all of us have heard that cycle, and that's incredible. And then the dark songs in Schwanengesang, like Der Atlas, for instance. Der Atlas is another kind of a passacaglia, which just has those four chords that run through the whole piece. So he was clearly experimenting with some forms of minimalism, and to great effect as well. I mean, I think that the compact narrative of the fantasy is one of its incredible features. It's a hard piece to listen to, too, I think. I think it's complicated, especially the fugue. And to track it well is hard, you know, when that thing keeps coming back. That's a big, big challenge to do that. But when I compare, those are the works that I can think of off the top of my head that are closest to the spirit of the fantasy and the way it, especially the way it concludes. I mean, I'm not sure what was your thinking again? Yeah.
What range the Chaconne for both hands?
Busoni is the main one. And the Busoni is, I don't like it, but I had a student who came in to have a lesson on it. And then I did what I usually do. I got very rigorous about the text and watching exactly what was in the text. And if you play it with care, and a consummate attention to detail, it really works. If you start getting slap happy with it, it generalizes it, and I don't think it has the same effect. Busoni is very precise about what he wants, and really has a big dynamic range and a lot of color in it. So, you know, these things, we always have to revisit them. I do. I get a certain impression of it, and then you come in and take a close look at it, and you go, wow. I have a sign in the studio that said, it says in very big letters, read what's plainly on the page. And then the rest of it is in very tiny letters, and it talks about emotional expression and poetry and imagination and all that stuff. But you need an electron microscope to read that one. The first part is read what's plainly on the page. It can tell us an awful lot.
Schubert is not someone that I would attracted to immediately, but listening to your talk, one thing that I got from Schubert was this sense of mortality.
Oh yeah.
It was very, very clear for me. And I just wonder any comments you might have about,
bright and rosy future for you where Schubert's concerned. I promise you, because this is a tough little nut. But listen to the, I would listen to the Schubert-Millerman vocal music, if you like that. That's irresistible. Listen to the Great Symphony. And there's a wonderful live performance with the wonderful orchestra of Munich with Bernstein conducting, I think from the 70s. And that's something. I mean, first of all, you have him helping you because he shows with his body as clearly as one can with words, the shapes of phrases, the energy, the intensity, all that. I was really blown over by that performance. I only came to it about 6 months ago for the first time. Try that, see what you get. I think there's hope. The city is charity.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Yeah.
Was this music composed at a time when Schubert knew that he was about to die? Was he having to grapple with that, his own mortality, and that's why it's so infused in this piece of music?
This is your subject. You know more about this than I do.
Yeah.
Well,
I mean, it was the last year of his life. He had tertiary syphilis, and he had that for a long time. But he ultimately died of typhoid. So I don't know if he knew he was going to die at that time.
He was staying with his brother Ferdinand out in the suburbs of Vienna, and the water was bad. And he also had, I don't know how these guys did it, because Beethoven had the same thing. I have a very, very short fuse if my tummy hurts. I mean, I'm really useless. Beethoven and Schubert had bad tummies for years. And Schubert's routine was he got up at 6 in the morning and composed until 12. And at the end of the first movement of the B-flat string quartet, which is an extended piece of some 400 measures, he writes, composed in 4 hours. Now, his ballpoint pen didn't work too good. So this required the mechanics of taking a quill pen, dipping it in ink, writing the music, and pouring sand on it. I've often been intrigued to see if somebody could copy that score with modern equipment in anything like 4 hours. Never mind, you don't have to know a single thing. Just sit there and put all those little dots and all those little stems down and all the slurs and the markings, and Schubert's manuscripts are pretty nice looking. That, to me, is astounding. And by the way, in terms of Schubert, I always liken him to the English poet John Keats, who died at the age of 26, but stopped writing poetry when he was 24, and only got really good when he was 21. I'm looking at the Chapman's Home, where it's written when Keats is 21, and then he was one of the 6 probably greatest poets in the English language in 3 years, and he was too sick to write after. You know, and there's a lot about Schubert and Keats that I tend to glom onto when talking about the late piano sonatas. Just ways that he uses recurring motifs, very much like something like Keats's Ode on the Grecian Urn, which is just a variation of the same thing 6 or so times. And Schubert uses that. And there's even a place in the Ode to a Nightingale, which is mirrored, seems to be, at the end of the slow movement of the Age of Piano Sonata. I like these analogies, because for me, they're tournaments. You know? I mean, anything that you can do to increase your pleasure, do it.
I also want to mention that when I first had the Chaconne explained to me, I was quite impressed. I'd heard it on the marimba. I mean, I've heard it on all the other instruments, but the marimba, this particular performance, was very moving.
Of the Chaconne?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
It does work beautifully. With
the Swingle singers were good on Bach.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But it was explained to me that he had written this after he returned from a tour that he'd made and found out that
his wife
had passed while he was away. And so it also is dealing with mortality, but not his own. He might have felt as if it was his own, but that those two pieces are kind of brought together on that theme.
Well, Gardner in his movie, shows an image of a young boy walking through a graveyard, and he depicts this as Bach passing the graves of all of his all of his brothers and sisters who didn't survive infancy. So that was definitely with him all the time. And then we have to think about joyous time in Kirchheim when he was writing all that instrumental music. And then that court collapsed, and suddenly he's on his own. And there's a, you know, it's sort of funny, when he got the job in Leipzig, they really wanted Telemann. And one of the people on the committee who was going to choose who Telemann, who the successor to the person before was going to be, made the terrible mistake of going down in history about saying, when you cannot have the very best, you must go for the second best. And that was J.S. Bach. Think of all the things you'd rather not have said. Okay, let's do the Schumann. This is the wonderful last mini Gotterdammerung of a set of pieces called Pieces for Big and Little Children. And Schumann sometimes just excels. You'll notice that none of the music tonight was for two hands at the piano. The first piece was for one. The second was for four, and this is